Well, hello everyone. This is Al-Fadi, and I am so excited to start a brand new video series that deal with the historical criticism of Islam. And obviously, whenever I mention the word historical criticism, I am certain that many of you think usually of Dr. J. Smith, and you are absolutely correct, because with me here in studio right now, who will work on unpacking a number of issues related to the historical criticism of Islam, is no other than our dear brother, Dr. J. Smith. Now, the reason why we wanted to do something related to that and really putting it all together, technically speaking, that's the way we want to call it, is that many of you have been commenting on his channel and even sometimes on my channel, asking us to put all of these different series and all of the wealth of information that has been shared with you concerning the standard Islamic narrative and the many problems in there in a way, in a series that simplifies all of that at least, and maybe follow a logical order, if you wish. And that's why we are going to do this particular series. And as I mentioned, with us here in studio to unpack all of that is our dear brother, Dr. J. Smith. Dr. J., thank you so much as always, and it's a pleasure to work with you, especially on a topic like this that is becoming worldwide really popular, if you wish, and many times people are relying on this information, believe it or not, to now counter the Islamic argument. But here is the other positive things. I'm receiving a lot of messages from Muslims who left Islam on account of things like this.
Yeah, and I think this is important that we do a overall wrap-up. This is, what, 2022. What and where are we going with this material? What have we found up to this point? Mm-hmm. Looking at the comments, and listen, we are looking at the comments. I have been looking at the comments on mine and also on Al-Fadi's site. I've been doing that purposely so that we can see what you're saying. And what you're saying is an understandable problem, and that is there's just too much material. We're getting all the stuff coming out from the Sin Sifters, from Thomas Alexander, from Mel, from Odin. We're getting an awful lot of new stuff that's coming in from Murad and Lloyd and Peter and Joe. Too much material. How can we really understand it? It's that you can't see the forest for the trees, because there's so many of them around you. There's so many ideas. Conflicting ideas. I mean, we have this new debate that's happening within the Sin Sifters between Thomas Alexander and Mel concerning the Dome of the Rock.
That's right. Yeah.
And so what we've decided, Al-Fadi and I, is to come together and try to look at, looking down from above, what we're really saying, what we think really happened, why each one of these categories is important, and how they all fit together. So this is kind of an overview. And we're going to cover four areas.
Right. And I think the areas, if I may jump here, has to do with the problem of the sources.
Yeah, and why is that important?
Well, I mean, because many times we've emphasized the fact that you have sources that Muslims rely on that are later sources. Later. You know, you're missing eyewitness accounts sometimes. Sources that do not collaborate at least the 7th century. Rise of Islam, or the 7th century existence of a man by the name of Muhammad, or the 7th century, the existence of a preserved complete Quran. I mean, there's so many things when it comes to the sources. And that's, I think, some of the stuff that you will be unpacking for us also in this particular series.
Yeah. This, now, and I will say one thing also to the audience. One of the problems that I have had coming here into the studio with Al-Fadi is that I do the lion's share of the speaking, and a number of you have complained, Jay, shut up. We want to hear Al-Fadi speak more. And that's understandable. What people don't realize is I'm invited into the studio to introduce the new research. Al-Fadi is hearing it for the first time, much of this. So that's why he has to listen. But what I want to do this time around is I want you to speak more, because I'm tired of people telling me to shut up all the time. So I'm going to make sure you're on the hot seat. I'm going to make sure you are responding, because you've now heard everything that we're going to be introducing. Exactly. You have now heard. And I want to see what you say, because you are from this area. This is your land. We're going to be talking about Mecca. This is your background. We're going to be talking about Islam. You were a Muslim. This was your prophet. We're going to be talking about Muhammad. And we're also going to be talking about the sources. Because you have been brought up believing, from your background, you've always been told that there was a man named Muhammad who received a book called the Quran between 610 and 632, who lived in a place called Mecca in the 7th century, well, from 570 up to 632. So begin end of the 6th century, moving into the 7th century. This is what you have been brought up with. This is everything you've known. This is everything all of us have known. Why is it you trusted it? And why is it we have always trusted it? That's why we need to start with the sources.
Correct.
Now, in your background, you didn't have a choice to...
That is true. And it's kind of interesting you mentioned that because you cannot really dare to question things like this when you are basically a Muslim or at least live in an Islamic context. And even if, you know, let's use today, there is a lot of young Muslims who are definitely taking note of these kind of discoveries and these kind of shows, but they still hesitate to expose their openness to the fact that there is a problem in our narrative. And that's really what this boils down to. I mean, speaking of narrative, I mean, June 8th is what is labeled as the
holes in the narrative.
Holes in the narrative.
The standard Islamic narrative, holes in the standard Islamic narrative. We're going to be talking about that.
Yasser Qadhi, you know, and his incident with Mohammed Hijab.
That one interview. 2 years ago. Yeah. Happened 2 years ago. So we're even putting down when we're having these discussions. Now, I think it's important, and this is where we're going to go back and forth. In this series, we'll be doing a lot more discussing. We'll be looking at some things on the screen, but more than the fact, I want to throw questions at you. I want to throw ideas at you. I want you to then respond to the questions I'm going to be throwing at you so that we have a discussion back and forth so that people can see that they can do the same thing. All of you can do the same thing. Everything that we'll be discussing today, I'm hoping you will be doing that with your Muslim friends. Or you Muslims are discussing this in your mosques or with your family or with your fellow Muslims. You need to ask these kind of questions because almost everything we're going to be talking about covers four distinct areas. The first we've talked about, and that's the sources.
Right. And then we have the problem with Mecca.
Well, we're going to talk about the book, The Man and the Place.
Right.
The book, The Man and the Place. You've heard us say that many times. No one calls it the book, The Man. That's what I call it because it's quick, it's easy. It's like a meme that you can just go to any Muslim and say, let's talk about the book, let's talk about the man, talk about the place. What's the book?
Well, that's the Quran,
of course. That's the Quran. Why is that important?
Well, you know, everything about Islam has to do with the book. And, of course, you can't separate the book from the man, by the way. And you can't separate the book, the man, from the place. All of it work together. But the book, of course, is allegedly a revelation from God. It's a continuation of prophecies that came in the Old Testament and the New Testament. So it ties itself to the Bible. And at the same time, the book tells you to do certain things that if you do not follow, first, you're not a Muslim. Second, you're not technically speaking accepted anymore by the God who sent the prophets before Muhammad. So it's a big deal for someone who follows Islam because it's the finality psychology. You know, it's like you're following the final message by the final prophet to all of humanity. And this is why Muslims get locked into this psychological thinking that, hey, we follow the best of the best, technically speaking.
Well, it's the one that corrects that which comes earlier. So the book itself, that's the book. This is it right here, the Quran. This is the book that corrects that they could consider which comes before, which has been corrupted abrogates that which comes before. That's why we're going to confront this. But we're going to put this at the very end. Though we say the book, the man, and the place, I'm actually going to flip it. Because before we even talk about the book or the man, that would be Muhammad, we need to talk about Mecca. Mecca is what we're going to go with first. Now, why Mecca? Because the book and the man all take place in one area. And the standard Islamic narrative, we're going to be defining that next. When we get to the standard Islamic narrative, we're going to see that that man lived in a place called the Hijaz. That's where Mecca and Medina are, the central part of Arabia, towards the western coast. Not on the coast, but inland a little bit. That's where you grew up. You grew up in that area. You're from that area. This is your native environment. This is your native area. That's why I want you to talk about it.
Absolutely. And I want to add, I mean, you mentioned Mecca. To me, Mecca means two important things, the birthplace of Muhammad and the direction of the Qibla. And you can see why we have a lot of problems with those.
Well, it goes way deeper than that. This is where Adam and Eve lived. This is where Abraham lived in 1900 BC. This
is where Muslim, Muhammad is a big deal and the Qibla is a big deal.
This is where all the trade routes went through. Yeah. This is the beginning. This is where all the prophets were buried. Every 300 prophets were buried.
Which we did a show on that, yeah.
So this is why Mecca is huge. Because for a Muslim, Mecca is the center of history. Mecca is the center of the world. That huge clock tower that they have built, it's going to be the center of time. And that's why we're going to start with Mecca. But before we do that, we need to talk about the standard Islamic narrative. Absolutely. We need to see what is it and where is it Muslims are coming from. And that will be the next episode.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for sharing that. Again, everyone, hopefully you will be enjoying this series. And as we mentioned, there are four problems that we will be unpacking in this series. To be honest, we don't even know how many videos we will be able to produce out of this, but it's going to be a lot. So we're going to talk about the problem of the sources, the problem of Mecca, the problem of early Islam slash the man, which is Muhammad, and then the problem with the book, and that's the Quran. But before we do all of this, next show, we will begin to unpack to you what is meant by S-I-N, sin, or the standard Islamic narrative. Thank you, Dr. J. Thank you, everyone, for watching. Until next time, have a blessed day.